The PS1 is my favourite games console of all time. There's just something about it. I was a very lucky kid. My family were far from wealthy, but being an only child, I had access to video game consoles from a very early age. My dad had a Commodore 64 when I was very little, not that I could really understand how to actually play it, because all the games ran off these fucking cassettes. Then, he got a Sega Mega Drive, or a Genesis to my American comrades. This opened up the opportunity for me to play the classics such as Sonic, Quackshot, World of Illusion, Decap Attack, and several more. Good times. Then, for a birthday, I was given a SNES, or an SNES. Incredible times. Getting to play Super Mario World, Donkey Kong Country, Earthworm Jim, Killer Instinct, and any other game I could really get my hands on. Eventually, for another birthday, there was an N64 thrown into the mix, but this did arrive after the PS1, and beyond the big players such as Super Mario 64, Ocarina of Time, and Majora's Mask, the rest of the games I played were always rented, and it didn't see much love from me at the time until I was a bit older. The reason for the lack of love is in 1994, my dad bought himself this beautiful grey box of polygonal goodness. Obviously not this one, but one just like it. The console came packed with two games, Worms and Zero Divide. Back in the day, all the PS1 games in Europe were in these things called big boxes for a while. They were sexy as fuck. My dad started bringing back more games such as Doom, Tekken, and of course Crash Bandicoot. This game was a mainstay in our family for some time. The PS1 was my dad's, so it was always in the living room, and we would get together as a family and play through games together. A pretty alien concept to me now. I wouldn't boot up Resident Evil Village and holler my mom in for a spin with a keyboard and mouse. But back then, that was the way it was done. I have this really vivid and cherished childhood memory of me and my mom trying to play through the boulder levels in Crash 1, but not being able to finish them. So we had the controller at the same time, taking half each, and I would do the movement and she would just focus on the jumping, and eventually we beat the levels together. After a while, probably because I would pester him non-stop if I could play it, the console did wind up being in my room. So with my shitty little CRT TV, I would bathe in the glow of the PS1 for hours at a time, creating memories with games like Metal Gear Solid, Final Fantasy 7, Resident Evil, Crash, Doom, and many more. Now why the fuck have I spent the first few minutes of this already way too long video telling you about this? Because one, I just wanted to show you how much I love this console, and two, this leads me into another thing that was fucking awesome about it. These beautiful bastards were amazing. You had one included with the PS1 called Demo 1 in the earlier days, which had these classics. Look at this. This fucking T-Rex scared the shit out of me when I was a kid. And Enlightenment.
Wer denn you? Hong Ja, Hong Jai. Nigga Ming Wan!
It has this weird dark vibe, like you found a Jumanji game or something, but it's actually just a really cool video selling peripherals for the PS1. Alongside this, you would get a demo every week through the official PlayStation magazine, and these were the best magazines I think that have ever existed. I still have a bit of my collection, sadly not enough in my opinion, but if you fancy a blast of nostalgia, check this out. One disc that I love is this one, the Best Horror Games Ever disc. It features playable demos of Resident Evil, Silent Hill, Quake 2, Soul Reaver, Dino Crisis, Nightmare Creatures, Deathtrap Dungeon, Carmageddon, Doom, and Exhumed. Remember that last name for a future video. I mean, what a disc! What a time to be alive! But this specific disc brings us nicely to today's feature presentation. The Haunted PS1 demo discs are a collection of short games or demos that are in a way emulating this very disc. The demos are pretty self-explanatory, and the shorter games actually remind me of Netorosie games, which are short, fan-made games using a fucking dev PS1 that will sometimes get featured on demo discs. The Haunted PS1 community is a beautiful place for people like me who genuinely love the aesthetic from the PS1 era, not solely for nostalgic reasons. Like, games peaked in that that period. Not visually, of course, but without relying on newer visuals, the meat and potatoes that makes a game had to be so much more refined. Which is why I believe that some of the best games ever made came from that era, and for me, that console specifically. It was a time in gaming where the games themselves were just dripping with creativity and innovation. The Haunted PS1 Demo Disc 2021 contains a whopping 25 games, which is fucking incredible for a free release. Yes, free! Just like the demo discs of old, even though you had to pay for the magazine, but we'll ignore that for now. I'm going to go through every one of them in this video, and I understand that might be a lot, so the video is chaptered game by game, so you can come back to it later if you don't fancy doing it all in one go. And if you'd rather experience them all for yourself first, of course, the link to the itch.io page for the demo disc is in the description, so please feel free, go grab it. It is free again. Anyway, off we go, I guess. When the game starts, you're down a random back alley in a snowy, deserted town. Very Silent Hill, which I enjoy. You eventually find a dimly lit door down the end of another alley. Once you go inside, you'll find yourself in some sort of museum. The receptionist is none other than Scully, the beautiful purple mascot of Haunted PS1. He explains that the museum is full of games birthed from the accursed minds of your world. He also kind of reminds us that we can't smoke or die in here, and not to get our corpse germs on everything. Great life advice, really. The museum has a rather impressive centerpiece in the lobby, and an elevator in the back that leads to 3 floors. Each floor has 10 games on it, except for the 3rd floor, which has 5. Honestly, when I walked out of this lift and saw the amount of games on this floor, I nearly shit canned the video because of how daunting the task ahead seemed. What is super cool is each game has a little entrance area that reflects the environment of the game you're about to play, and each one has an interactable object that will launch said game. But this is actually the last you're going to see of this place until the end of the video when we get to some extras. So, first game. Okay, so we seem to have fallen down a hole of some kind. First thing right off the bat, this game has a very nice feel to the movement. Lovely work on that. So we do some exploring around this seemingly abandoned storage area. Then this fucking creeper's just chilling on the other side of the door. He asks us what we're doing down here. Says this area is off limits to the likes of us. Then shows concern because we're pale. He asks us to follow him to his office. Ha! Nah, get fucked, you stuck up prick. I'll stay in here sweating and pale.
Where are you going?
Whoa, 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 what the fuck was that, mate? Doesn't mean any harm, eh? Bollocks. Listen, kids, if you take one thing from this video, if you find yourself in a situation like this, dive out the fucking window.
Come back here now.
What the fuck? What did I do? Right, against all my better judgment this time, I will follow him. Let's see what happens.
This doesn't seem good.
What you
doing?
I don't like this.
Of course.
Where are you going?
I fucking knew it. Where am I going? Fucking shut that.
Where are you going?
A dead end, eh? Fucking what? This way,
where
I guess?
Where are you going? Where are you going?
Is going down here the best thing to do?
Where
I don't know.
Are you going?
Where the fuck did he go? Right, check me this time, dickhead. Oh dear, another dead end. Well. What the fuck? Whoa. I'll just wait here then.
Where are you going?
Yeah, mate, no worries, yeah? Yeah, it's all good. I'll just head there first, yeah? See you, dickhead. Right, what's in here? I'll be behind this desk and... Ooh. Oh, shit, score, boys. Right, I don't know where he is, but I'm just gonna crawl my way out of here. Looks like this is my way out, eh? Ha, see you, dickhead. Oh shit, it's a death line. Unpassable. So it turns out I smashed it on my first real attempt, because I think you have to get caught because this is only a demo. Damn fine one though. Really unsettling and very well put together. Great job. Next game.
So
So with this demo, you started off at the bottom of a staircase with what seems to be a magical barrier blocking our progress. I've got to say, I love the way this game controls and the more modern take on a fixed camera angle perspective. It swings around to make sure you can always see and never left me annoyed or confused about what was going on. The game is very Silent Hill mixed with RE, as you can probably tell just by looking at it and the environment and everything. You have to explore this school for items to solve puzzles on your way around. It's very nice. You do things like using these scissors to snap piano wires, and then using this drain cleaner we found on this shit-filled toilet to clear it out, then combining the string with the magnet to get the key out the toilet, eventually remembering where there was a locked door to find a rather interesting blue orb inside. Take this back to the stairs and we can explore a bit further. We find ourselves in this very dark room. Pretty creepy shit, to be honest. And then...
what the ever-loving fuck is this? What? Drum and bass. Bullet hell gameplay. What?
And there you go. Great little game, to be fair. Certainly knows how to make a horror setting with great modern day fixed camera angles and seemingly some fresh ideas thrown in there as well for things like boss fights, what have you. Really good job. I know that was a short review there, but it was pretty short anyway. Most of it was exploring, so definitely check it out. If you're a fan of RE or Silent Hill, you will enjoy it. Next game. This game starts with someone being beaten and abused down an alley. As he gets back up and leaves, he falls to the ground and passes out. Bad times. Next, our man is driving down a freeway to get out of town. He has a girl in tow. They talk about lots of emotional things for quite some time. Interesting thing to note is that his radio is bleeding though. The car eventually breaks down, conveniently right outside this motel. We make our way inside and there doesn't seem to be anyone working here. The game actually lets you explore the whole motel straight out the gate and read lots of notes and get really immersed in its world, which I did. After what was no lie about 10 minutes of running around, I realized we could go behind the counter and grab this key to room 109. Luckily, thanks to my running around blind, I know where that is, but I also know that there's a mail room. An opening box at 109 grabs us some pliers. In a lovely homage to Silent Hill 4, when you enter the bedroom, the game becomes first person. You can grab some random items here, like a coat hanger, use a weird little head on the bedside cabinet as a storage device, and also save your game, and then go to sleep. During the night, our man hears a scream or something from a few doors down, and like a real horror situation protagonist, wants to go investigate. After about another 6 minutes of exploring the entire motel in the wrong direction, I realize the place I need to go is actually out the back of the room, and then just head next door. There's a note here mentioning a car parked in the furthest away spot. I used the pliers I got earlier with the coat hanger I found in the room to make a straightened hanger and went for a brisk jog into the night. Eventually, I stumble across a car. Some sort of fleshy substance seems to be attached to it. I don't know what the fuck's going on, but I used the hanger on the door and get the 113 key. I've got to say, even in this short experience, the atmosphere in this game is fucking incredible. Like, nothing much really happened this whole time I've just been exploring, but it sets the scene so well. It's genuinely like Resident Evil or Silent Hill levels of world building, and we haven't even seen a threat yet. Back in the mail room, I decide to open 113's box, and we find some bullets, a weird letter about the hotel and their Second Amendment rights, the key to room 101, and at last, a weapon. This game has the most survival horror reloading system I've ever seen. You have to push the triangle button, then slide the slide back, hold the X button and remove the magazine, then slide in another magazine, and then slide the slide back. It's a very cool idea, and I imagine in high pressure situations it would get really out of hand, because this is the only way to reload, by the way. The letter told us to go to room 101 with the gun, but on the way... yeah, fuck that. Over to room 101.
What the fuck is going on in this?
We find a nice baseball bat in the room, and looky, looky here.
That's a home run. This is getting fucking ridiculous. Fucking die. Oh, fuck are you?
Why won't you die?
Fuck me.
As you can see, the enemies in this game don't fuck about. This time I'm running past everything and heading straight to room 101. Finally, something I can kill. But where the fuck is the garden? A casual 5 minutes of running around later. This doesn't look much like a garden, but it is the end of the demo, and this little guy tells me in a very meta and cool way. This game seriously has some potential. It is obviously aimed towards people who are fans of Resident Evil and Silent Hill, and if that's you, make sure you grab this demo and check it out. You will not be disappointed. This one is going to be on my radar for sure. Great game. Next game. Lunar Effect is one of the games featured on this demo disc that I had actually heard about prior to its release. It is yet again another RE/SH inspired game, like many of the ones included on the demo disc. You better get used to that. Outside of that inspiration, the mansion itself really reminded me of the one from Eternal Darkness too. By the way, never think I'm saying that these games take reference of these games in a negative way. I love all of the games they take reference from, and I love to see indie devs use that inspiration and make something fresh with the mechanics. This game seems like it has a lot of potential for some puzzles. The game begins you in like an escape the room sequence, which I fucking love. You have notes all around to read for clues, and a clock that is locked with a 4-letter passcode, the answer to which is found in one of the notes in the room, and it's the first letter from each first word on each line of this poem. I love shit like that. The clock contains the bedroom key, and we're free to explore the demo portion of the mansion. We also get whacked with a 30-minute timer, which very kindly pauses when you're reading notes. I find a codex guide stashed in this bookshelf, and make our way further through the gorgeous set design. We stumble upon a kid's room, and find a key in the dollhouse representation of the house we're in. We also find a little toy version of Scully, who also happens to have some important messages for the kids. In another room, we find this delightful little light puzzle where we have to match up the mobile to the shadows on the wall. It's very well done. This reveals a message on the wall. Our man needs a pencil before we can start trying to transcribe it. Luckily, the very room we started in happens to have a pencil part on the side of the bed. How handy. And we jot down what we can on our codex. Uh-oh. Seems like someone's had a bad time in the bathroom. So it seems like someone or something has smashed its way through the boarded up window. It took me a while to notice, but there's also some symbols written on the floor in here too. That completes our codex. Now we get to the real big puzzle of the demo, using our codex to decipher whatever was written on the typewriter. I absolutely love puzzles like this. They're not insanely hard or anything, because you're just checking things against one another. But it's just something so satisfying about turning something completely illegible into something that fills a section of a story. This game really is my cup of tea. Once the passage has been figured out, the fucking wardrobe comes to life. And upon inspection, it's empty, with just a key inside. We use the servant's key to head into the servant's quarters. Inside there's a dumb waiter that doesn't appear to have any power. We find a note that the character compares to the ramblings of a madman, and the second half to a key I found in the dollhouse. Luckily, this opens up the storage room inside the servant's quarters, and once we're inside the closet, we have a delightful little puzzle with two lines of power that need connecting up. A lot like the ones from Resident Evil 2 Remake, if you remember those. Quite a lot of fun. So, the power back on, time to check on that dumb waiter. I love the fact he's just sat there in the dumbwaiter and the creature's running towards him and he's just like, nope, I can't see you there, sir. Right, there we go. End of the demo. Gotta say, that was a hell of a lot of fun. Very well made. Beautifully made textures and environments. Good controls. Great puzzles. Just an all-round great time for me. One to watch out for sure. Next game. Fiend's Isle is a cheeky little game based on Dungeon Explorer games from back in the day. Heads up. I fucking suck at games like these. Here's a prime example of me meeting our very first enemy in the game. The game's world is randomly generated. You always start on this pier, but the caves in the mountains and the enemy placements will always be different by the looks of things. There are trap rooms like this scattered throughout as well, which have a switch at the other end. Sadly, I never got far enough to discover what the Switch actually does, but there you go. The reason I never got far enough is these fucking skeletons. They just don't make sense. I tried so hard to hit them and dodge them, but the character just doesn't seem to be able to do it. I mean, I don't get it. It's 100% me, I'm sure. But I just can't seem to get these fuckers to die or move out the way. Look. Yeah, not for me. Sorry. Well made, but I'm no good at these games. Next game! So, Echo Stasis is a game with a very clear visual style straight out the gate. That sort of VHS 80s computers from the movies look. And because of that, I got lost for the first 5 minutes of my time with this game. But eventually we find our way to this synthwave chapel and get a pretty eerie warning from this statue inside. It told me to turn back, so I do. And I find this fucker. We wake up in a lobby with a computer inside. After a little chat, the game tells us that we can enter any command that is found inside the terminal, inside these brackets, and it'll ask the computer that question. I'll try the obvious mature question first, then ask the computer to tell me more about the situation. Turns out we're a janitor that works here, and here is a place where people get connected to a digital world, somewhat akin to heaven, called Utopia. There, they can relive happy memories or fantasies. This part is somewhat like a puzzle. You have to ask the computer the correct commands to proceed. The game needs us to check on someone that is stuck inside their stasis chamber, grabbing their ID off the door.
You're right there, mate. I'll have you having a jiffy, sir.
Seems like the person in there is in trouble and we need to get them out. The only way to do this is to run a program that is highly dangerous, of course. We need to grab the engraving off the top of the console, then we can hack in and try and help this person. Then we're dropped into this old Victorian London looking motherfucker with a 1 minute timer up in the corner. I didn't really understand what I was doing the first time, but eventually the penny dropped. You have to make it as far as you can each time and try to change something so the next time through will be easier and faster. So the first time you have to run as far as you can and open this door. Then the next time you boot in, you have a nice shortcut to keep going deeper. You continue doing this, making your way deeper, opening a few more shortcuts. Then eventually, we exit the dreamscape and our friendly computer is having a hard time, seemingly falling apart at the seams with corruption. There's some madness going on in the Echo Stasis, and it seems the subject inside the Echo Stasis is completely fucked. Thank you. Echo Stasis is a great demo. I don't really know where it would go if it was made into a more full experience, but it really was quite unique. I enjoyed all the mechanics at play, and the story was really great and interactive. This is a real standout. Great job. Next game. This is Walk, a game that uses photos as pre-rendered backgrounds from what I can tell, and images as textures for things like this girl's face. It's unsettling as shit and very well made. You spend the first little while running around the area, kind of at a loss of what to do, and trying to find where the screen edges actually are, but eventually... Was that a fucking fish? Well, that unsettling nightmare fever is now patrolling the area, and we have to find some items to continue. Like this key in a vending machine. We have to find 200 yen scattered around, but this bitch is so freaky it makes exploring terrifying. Oh shit, she's coming back.
Don't see me, wench.
Right, that doesn't sound good. Or look good. What the fuck did she do to me? After some time and a lot of crouching behind things, I do happen upon my first 100 yen, which actually looks like a British pound coin, I'll have you know. So now we're halfway to getting the key. Turns out the other one is actually right over there. You can just about see the shimmer in the distance. Perfect. Off to the vending machine. Luckily, I don't think that evil bastard can get into this screen. Thank God. And there we go. I actually do know where the locked gate is, so I'll just sneak my way over there now. Right, here we are. Maybe this is the end of the demo.
Wait. Where the fuck am I? What the fuck?
Yeah, I'm not doing all that again. Took me about 30 minutes to sort all that shit out. So, this game, really creepy. Fantastic atmosphere. It's a little hard to tell where you're going and where the screen corners are, that sort of thing. You know, you might be looking at a screen and it doesn't look like there's anywhere to go because of the picture, but it turns out there actually is just another exit off the side of the screen if you hit it at a very specific angle, that sort of thing. I mean, that death at the end there was absolute bullshit. I couldn't tell where I was, couldn't tell which way it wanted me to go, but, you know, nothing's perfect. Other than that, it was a really scary time. Like, the monster sounds and everything, truly terrifying. Good job. Next game! Janitor Bleeds is the second game on this demo with Bleeds in the title. The game starts with a short exposition regarding people going missing and abandoned vehicles being found miles away from anywhere. We're also started next to a car and have to walk down a beautifully PS1 road through the woods. We wind up at an abandoned building surrounded by old wrecked cars, and there's a flashlight left on the bonnet of a nearby wreck. Some handy graffiti helps us make our way inside the building, which turns out to be an old arcade. Now, I'm telling you, the atmosphere in this game is second to none. Exploring this place with the low hum that is constantly there and the low light of the flashlight being the only comfort is very effective. There's something extra unsettling about walking through a place that is supposed to be designed for happiness and fun, but is now just full of darkness, emptiness, and maybe something else. I eventually come across some coins on the desk and then embark on a quest to find as many of these things as I can before I attempt to continue on. Shortly thereafter, making my way into the office, we have to vault over this fallen set of shelves and we find the green key. Also, rather comfortingly find the power. Sadly, the other green door is located in the frankly terrifying toilets. Inside, I expected a jump scare, but was instead greeted with an arcade machine, along with some other helpful graffiti. Don't worry, I won't pluh. I've never been known to pluh in my life. The game, rather extortionately, requires 3 coins per play, and you have to actually crouch down and pop them in one at a time, which always made me think I'd be jump scared when I pop back up. The game is a little 8-bit adventure, where you go around the building and mop up puddles. I can see why this one was kept in the back. It's not exactly going to compete with Street Fighter 2 now, is it? So, the game goes on for a little while, then... and we find a key. We open the yellow door in the game and clean up another mess. There's a glitch trapped in the middle of this room, so I'm gonna go around, clean up some more pesky puddles, drink a Mountain Dew, eat some Doritos, and find that key like the god I am. Right, there we go. The Dew and Doritos are mixing weirdly in my mouth to form a bizarre paste, but we have the key.
And they stole my fucking arcade cabinet. Unbelievable.
Oh, I wonder where I need to go. Right. Power's fucked. That's great. Some more handy graffiti helps us go true cod in here and go prone. Eventually we follow some quite frankly fucking terrifying sounds into an office that contains the arcade cabinet. There is also clearly something on the other side of this window. The game is now recreating real life, so let's go see what was around that corner. Oh, a key! Back in the game, we can grab the yellow key and actually deliver it to ourselves outside of the game so we can get out of the office. So, now what's gonna happen, eh? Oh shit, the air hockey table will save me! Back in the bathroom, I realised I could go prone under the toilet doors, and I thought I would find something of use, or at least someone taking a shit waiting to jump scare me. But instead, so the arcade machine has moved again. So it's time for me to flex some more of those godlike gamer skills, I guess.
Yeah, boy. Wow. Jesus Christ, it's Jason Bourne.
After some expert cleaning skills, we get the blue key and bring it back over to our real life self. The final door is just ahead. And while I was so on edge I was playing this like a flick shooter, the demo just ends. This demo was honestly incredible. It has a great mechanic mixed into it. The atmosphere is top tier. There's just something about it. It's really well crafted and I highly, highly recommend this one. Amazing work. Next game. Apollisys is another fixed camera angle game, but this time taking us on a far more surreal trip than previously seen in this demo. I love this short experience. The visuals are extremely striking, and it was a lot of fun exploring this bizarre little area. We make our way inside the big red factory that has been looming over us since the demo began, which feels like home, apparently, then continue making our way upwards through some very well-crafted camera angles. This game makes me feel oddly nostalgic, like I've played it before somewhere, even though I 100% haven't. I think it just really taps into that perfect vibe of what the PS1 means to me. Then, of course, we arrive at a giant heart in a cage and actually have some cutscenes. While I have absolutely no idea what's going on, I'm all for it. I know that I'm gushing over this game a little bit, but I am just in love with these camera angles and environments. It's honestly half the battle in a low poly game like this. We eventually find ourselves bloodied and hung up on a wall, which seems to be some sort of puzzle. So we'll have to do some more exploring to see what we can come across. And speaking of coming, I'm literally about to over these visuals. We find someone who failed to achieve metamorphosis, whatever that could mean. And after a little more running around, we find something? Clearly I need to find some more things, so heading in the opposite direction leads us deeper down into this mechanical nightmarescape and I'm really trying not to gush, but fuck me, it's beautiful. We find another statue that I think is meant to be ourselves again, and the altar says,
"An altar to ruin. 10 swords pierce flesh. Tear away the skin. Is this our fate, seeker?"
And I guess gives me an item. Making our way back to our effigy, we witness it get quartered. And a door opens behind it. This leads us to another hellscape.
Yep.
Wow, that was seriously impressive. I don't know how this would be expanded upon, but just the way this was put together shows the creators understand what makes a PS1 styled horror game. It hit me right in that weird little PS1 node in my mind that gets set off when I watch old trailers for games for the consoles from the 90s. Incredible work. I'll be keeping an eye on this one for sure. Great job. Next game. Right. Unfortunately, you can't please everyone, and this game didn't please me. I can see what the game was going for, I really can, but I just think its execution is a bit heavy-handed. The introduction started well, with the real-life actors included, but as soon as the actual game started, it unfortunately lost me. You're wandering around a pretty barren MMO, which is to be expected, and you'll be teleported into a cutscene or something once you find the right way to go. While this idea isn't terrible in its own right, the size of these maps and the lack of interesting things held within is a little bit of a shitty combination. Then, there's the other players you interact with. I believe this demo is actively trying to point out the kinds of people that get attracted to MMOs. You have the people who are hardcore gamers and love being involved in the community, people who are going through struggles in real life and throw themselves into a virtual world and meet people around the world who have similar issues and maybe even blossom into true real life friendships. You also have people who are edgy, to say the least, who may self-indulge in the idea of being a lost cause and say things that make you roll your eyes and think, "Take it easy, chief." Then of course you have the trolls, the racists, the bigots and the idiots. The game basically places you in the world of an MMO that is being shut down, and all of these people are coming together and sharing why this is the worst thing that's ever happened. And for me, it was cringy as fuck. To add insult to injury, this was the only game on the entire collection that took me about 30 minutes to get working because it couldn't find the files that were right there in the game's folder. Great job. I didn't enjoy the writing, but I think I get what they were going for. But here's some personal highlights of mine so that you can see what the gist of this game is. Enjoy.
I've been playing this game for 12 years now. It cost me my marriage. I don't even see my kids anymore because on weekends I'm in the game.
Shut the fuck up.
I get the fuck out of here, homie!
We're dancing, we're fucking dancing.
You're a noob, aunt.
It was New Year's Eve. I was really high, and when I hung myself in the bathroom, something came in the room. It sounded like at first the emergency alert signal, and then some horrible crying, like a dying animal. I passed out from choking on the rope attached to the shower curtain bar, but that broke, and when I woke up, I could still hear the crying. I tried to hang myself on the towel rack, but that didn't work. So I opened the door to the hotel room, and as soon as I did, the noise went away.
I put anal beads up my ass, and now they're stuck there. I have anal beads stuck in my ass. I could fuck myself with hungry dildos.
There was a lot that led me to that moment. I believed I might be the reincarnation of Hitler. I would just sit in my car before class and cry and apologize to Anne Frank and all the victims of the Holocaust. Then, I thought I was the reincarnation of Jesus. According to the Bible, he's the only one who won't be forgiven. I thought I was the Antichrist. I feared my arms would turn into horrible knives that would stab this girl I liked in the vagina. She would just be kept alive in horrible pain, getting stabbed in the vagina until the universe ended. I love this game. But I ruined my life playing it. I know what you're saying. I have macrophilia, which is a fetish for giants. Ever since I could remember, when I watched movies like Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, I was turned on by that. I remember the part where the dad almost eats the son in a bowl of cereal, and I would just rewind that part over and over again. I watched it so much I wore out the tape.
In Dante's Inferno, one of the worst circles of hell is where sinners are chewed alive in the mouth of a giant saint for eternity. I remember reading it for high school English and masturbating to that part over and over again.
The Soul Order is a game where the main character is a prisoner in a convent of witches. They task you to enter the realm of the Endless Tree, bestowing upon you the magical ability to lay down enchanted salt that evil shall not pass. We enter a nearby portal that doesn't seem ominous at all, and are greeted by a handy dandy objective screen, informing us that we need to get into the church before the four bells ring, use the salt to protect ourselves, and keep the beasts in our sight. Oh dear. It doesn't take us very long to meet one of these beasts, forgivenly they don't just dive straight into our face. That scared the shit out of me, and you can tell by the haphazard salt laying that took place straight after. As you can see, the game uses one of those mechanics that when you're not looking at the enemy, it creeps ever closer. I've got to say, this game does it rather well too. There's something extra unsettling about the way they judder and the constant creaks and rumbles they make when they're nearby. We shortly stumble upon the church we're supposed to be looking for, which has a door locked by a key. There is also a blood trail nearby, so how about we follow that then, eh? Right, this time I'm going to surround this sucker in salt so I don't have to worry about him. You see, it's things like that that separate the amateurs from the pros, amigos. Ah, the second has arrived. You think I can't spin plates, game? Right, try this again.
Where the fuck did you come from?
This is the time, boys. Get past that, you shit. Right, which way is this blood going?
You bitch!
I have no idea how many of these fucking bells have tolled. I haven't been paying attention at all. I'm far too stressed. Well, well, well. Look at what we have here. Now, just time for us to get back in one piece. Ah, Christ, bugger off, you pair of chumps. Baba boy! Blocked off the whole path, you fools. I'm off ski. Right, I think the coast is clear.
Oh, God.
They really get me when they just pop up like that, you know what I mean? Right, get fucked. I'm getting in this church. And there we go. The character now walks down a long tunnel. I'm guessing to the realm of the Endless Tree where more horrors await. I really, really like this game. I'll be honest, I'm not very good at games with this sort of mechanic, but in this game, it's implemented really well. The enemies, while simple, are pretty fucking unnerving. And when they pop up out of nowhere, big spooks, boys, big spooks. Really impressive. Great work. Next game. So it's pretty clear that this game is highly influenced by the classic RE games, with a nice little mix of all the good parts of RE4 thrown in for good measure. You play as a hunk-like character called Hawk, who has to make their way through the underground lab and grab a keycard and a vaccine. Both of these are very kindly marked on the map, and the game controls beautifully. The demo only features the arcade mode at the moment, which procedurally generates lab maps for you to run through and get as high a score as possible. Once the full game releases, I believe it will have a story mode included, which really revs my engine. The main enemy in the game isn't too offensive, and you have a really great dodge roll that helps you glide through the area. This may sound like it's an OP move, but it is the kind of thing that blends really well with the OG and post RE4 styles that we've got going on here, and it comes in much more handy later in the demo. You can find some great things for just exploring this demo alone, like these little Scully dolls that give you a nice amount of points when you shoot them, a shotgun, and an assault rifle. After about 5 or 6 minutes of blasting your way through these very well decorated and fun to explore labs, you will find the vaccine. Once it's collected, the music ramps up a little bit. Then you get introduced to these bad boys. Now you can see what a dodge roll is so handy handy, because these big boys take quite a bit to go down, and one of the most effective strategies in old school RE games is to just dart your way through whenever possible. Once you arrive back at the lift, we have another big boy, but this one has to be taken down, so let's go! Suck on that, you dumb shit. Right, let's get out of here and see what score I got. Rank B, Turtle. I don't know what that means. Is that good? Possibly. But hey, download this game and see if you can beat it. It really is a lot of fun, and even in just the arcade mode, it has a lot of content and really made me want to go through it again straight away. I think this game with a story mode might be the best homage for OG / RE4 and onward fans could hope for. Excellent work. Next game. So I'm guessing by the name and some of the guns available to the player that this game is drawing its influence from Gmod, a game I've never played, so this probably won't go very well. Initially, I just ran around and made my way through this odd looking little door, which plonks me into the void and makes this error appear behind me. I think this is supposed to be the error texture from the Source engine, and we can throw it around a little bit with this game's version of the gravity gun. The error message also follows you around for some reason. Heading back through this door into the void and down here and... oh! Oh, it's dead. Now I make the fatal error of making my way down this dark ramp. I'll speed it up for you, but I basically walk backwards down this seemingly never-ending area, hunting for secrets that eventually just got me stuck as fuck down here. But luckily, we do have the option to reset ourselves. The game kindly informs me that if you push V, you enter God mode, which lets you fly around the map. After not much looking, we find this beautiful thing hiding out of sight, and it makes this sound when you touch it.
Fucking adorable.
This is another door we can go through. Okay. You can also use your rope gun to stick this error thing to the walls and watch it bounce around. And on my way back to push this little cutie around some more, I noticed a strange structure had appeared. Okay. Is that a lift? Where the fuck are we now? Well, I have no idea what was going on there, and I've never played Gmod, so I didn't get any of the references really. But you know what? I had fun wandering around its surreal and bizarre little world. Nice work. Next game. Right. Every now and then, when you play compilations and indie games for long enough, you will stumble across something so truly bizarre and unique. Mummy Sandbox is a prime example of that. So we start off as this little scarf in a tree. We have to hold out space to roll out and catch a rolling eye. That then drops us inside a little sandbox where we have to crawl around and collect little red scarves. Each scarf we collect slightly increases our speed. Eventually, we find a bucket on top of this hill, and that gives us the ability to dig and find more scarves. Once we find all the scarves, we learn the warp ability, which means we can basically go to more sandboxes and try and find more things. Another thing we can do once we've dug them up is exhume bodies? Right. Oh, look at that. I guess that's us then. Something that annoyed me here is that I couldn't get to the top of this sand pile in the middle and dig out every piece of sand in this area, so I continued on, and eventually we dig up a stick, an exhumant of a body that looks just lovely. Took me a while to figure out, but the stick I picked up is actually an item that I can give to this fucker on the wall, and it gives me some snazzy glasses.
Oh yeah, party time, baby.
In another sandbox, we find some scissors, and I instantly try and give them to a dog, which sounds weird, but even weirder is that the skeleton likes them and gives the sentient eyeball and scarf creature a new pair of shoes that allow it to jump. So now we can dig down this fucking middle pile of sand that's been bugging me this whole time and discover...
fuck off.
But you're getting the gist of this game now, yeah? You go around, you dig up items, you exhume people, you give the correct item to the correct exhumed corpse, and continue on in the game. It's bizarre, but strangely addictive. The game is later developed further by giving our little fella some shovels and adding the ability to build sandcastles, which we need to use to access the key from this exhumed person at the end of a demo. This bizarre but delightful little game is a hell of a lot more fun than it may sound or even look. It really reminded me of like a Netorosa game that you would find on an actual old PS1 demo disc. Unique, interesting, fun and quite addictive. Really great job. Next game.
I first saw it in the forest on the outskirts of my home colony, and followed it into an abyss. It led me downwards beyond retrieval, before finally disappearing. I have been lost for 253 years, a place where I'm not supposed to be. I need to find it again before my energy core expires. It's all I have left. There is no going back.
Lorne's Lure is a game made by Rubecki. If you're unfamiliar with Rubecki's work, their games over recent years have all had a pretty similar theme, which is climbing vast structures. These games were called Hatch, Do, Kill the Cough, or King of the Hill, and now Lorne's Lure. I have played all of these games, and I can say that while the subject may seem too oddly niche to be fun, they really are a great time. Rubecki has also been improving their craft with each installment. While the first installment, Hatch, was great, I personally couldn't get to the top of the mountain because I kept getting lost. Do and Kill the Cough were much shorter and more easily completable, and featured even more quality of life improvements. I also hold the world record for the Kill the Cough speedrun, by the way, which isn't as impressive as it sounds because I'm the person that made the category for a joke, and I always take a joke too far. One of the big quality of life improvements for Lorne's Lure is the fact that you have an optional waypoint marker that can be enabled or disabled at any point. Again, it's completely optional in case you love the idea of finding your way completely by yourself with no outside influence, but I had to use this because while it's not too hard to figure out where to go thanks to Rebecca's great level design, it really is helpful when deciding to go up or down or just trying to find out how far down it is you need to go next. After some running around, you find Lorne's climbing implements. These will look familiar to you if you've played any of Rebecca's previous games. They have once again improved the climbing, somehow making it both more realistic and smoother to use on a gameplay perspective. The HUD also now contains a lot of useful information at a glance, such as stamina, whether a wall is climbable or not, and how far away a surface is. Rubecki is amazing at creating an explorable world that feels not only unbelievably grand in scale, like you're climbing something otherworldly, but also so fleshed out and realistic, it simultaneously feels like it could be a real place. There are these terminals that you can interact with now as well, which work on lore building in this world, and really go a long way to making you want to explore every inch of this beautifully imagined place. You'll like notice a small light off in the distance, then analyse your surroundings to find the best way to get there, like you're climbing down a big mechanical tree as a kid. And when you get there, you'll find a log of a researcher who's also trying to figure out what this structure is made of, how old it is, and how it could even come to be, further building on the lore of the world. The games that Rubecki make aren't exactly amazing to watch, unless you're speedrunning them, because it is literally just climbing around. But they are amazing to actually play. You have to figure out the way you need to go and really get immersed in the world that is on offer here, and try and get into the character's plight to discover a way out of this place. We eventually discover the being that Lorne was lured in here by in the first place, the first time they have laid eyes upon it in 253 years, and then the demo ends. I will be grabbing this game to explore more of this world, and I highly suggest that you do the same. Rubecki is an extremely talented indie game dev, and one I've been following and supporting for some time. If you feel like playing something truly immersive and different, give the Lorne's Lure demo a try, and head over to its Steam page and give it a wish list. Great job as always, Rebecca. Next game. That Which Gave Chase starts you straight into the game on the back of a sled that you and your expedition partner are riding through some vast tundra. You have complete control over the sled, its right and left movement, as well as its speed. You can also tilt things further to stop yourself from tipping over, or tip yourself over if you want to. I'm a pro sledder, so I had no issues with this at all. Our partner will occasionally turn around and give us advice, and fill us in that we're searching for a cabin out here. At one point they did this. and I never really trusted them again. After some of the most hardcore dog sledding you've ever seen or could even imagine, we wind up at the cabin our partner was telling us about. We drop anchor and the story can continue. The scene changes and we're in the woods, seemingly by ourselves and equipped with a gun. The only other signs of life out here are the occasional howls from the sled dogs behind the trees. Seems our job is to follow these howls and collect our good boys. And yes, you can pet the dogs. Suddenly, someone begins shooting at us. I can only assume it's our partner. But why would they be shooting at us? We have to keep running, searching for the dark and unsettling woods, dodging bullets that come from anywhere, with creepy and unsettling noises surrounding us, having zero bearing on where we are or where we're heading. And then, the scene changes to our partner shooting what is either a caribou or a moose. And look at this fucking creeper.
Are you pleased with yourself?
When we get to the body of the animal, our partner says it's nearly completely ruined, so I'm guessing it's not edible. But why? We head back out on the sled and our partner remarks on the stillness that is found out here. And also, treasure. Oh, what a nice sprinkle of condescension too.
Fuck you, Giggles.
We ride throughout the night, in the darkness. Then through more tundra, with our partner telling us we can be of great use to one another. Then, we're alone, running alongside a herd of beasts. Or maybe, we're running with them. I have absolutely no idea what was happening in this demo, but it did one thing extremely well. Set a very unsettling scene. I think something has happened to our partner, and I think the treasure we were seeking turned out to be something more. What that is, I have no idea, but I certainly want to find out. Hopefully this game gets released soon so we can find out more, but holy crap, this game did make an impact on me. You should definitely give it a go and you will see what I mean. Good job. Next game. Chasing Static is another game that I'd heard of before I played this demo. It looks like it's going to be a big boy indie horror game that does really well. And after playing this demo, I genuinely hope it does do well because it is amazingly well made. The game starts us off with our protagonist driving down a long road at night. Beautiful low poly graphics surrounding us.
Holy shit! Is this game set in Wales? 10 out of 10. I love Wales. End the video.
We pull up to a little cafe rest stop and pop inside for a cup of coffee. So this game has some pretty fleshed out cutscenes that really set the scene. The lovely lady that works here lets us chill here and have a cup of coffee while she closes up shop, as long as we give her a lift home as we continue our drive down the long road. A nice arrangement. While I was gazing at the fizzy drink section, the power goes out to avoid any copyright infringement, and we're sent into the back to solve a neat little fuse box puzzle. We basically have to open a drawer, get the screwdriver, pry this drawer open for a spare fuse, and then use the paper to pop them in the right slots, and off to get our victory rewards from the lovely lady. Our man wakes up on the floor, strangely surrounded by a bunch of old analog recording equipment, and upon answering the phone, alright, Jigsaw, cheers for the heads up. So I choose not to go down the path that clearly leads into the woods and hop back into my car. So, seemingly impossibly, our man has survived this crash and we continue on down the dirt path. After about 2 minutes of running, I actually ended up back at the cafe. This was a nice touch. Like, I think the car crash was optional, like you're supposed to go down the path, but if someone's like, nah, fuck it, I'm leaving, you crash and end up there anyway. Eventually heading back down in the opposite direction, we come to a block road and a bunker. The path suddenly becomes clear, like there was some sort of glitch happening, and we stumble across a seemingly abandoned hut. Inside is the corpse of someone in a hazmat suit, and next to them is the bunker handle, and a note full of weird results by the looks of things. We make our way back to the bunker, pop on this new handle, crack it open, and make our way inside. This is tragically where the demo ends. I know that will have seemed short because I cut out all of the exploring and some of the conversations and stuff like that, but honestly, most of this demo is like 99% atmosphere and setting the scene. If you actually play through it, you'll be able to see that this demo actually holds a lot of potential for the full game, and I really can't wait to see where it goes with it. Excellent work. Next game. Ghastly Goodies starts with seemingly the worst parents in the world dropping us off at the end of a spooky driveway to do some trick-or-treating by ourselves, in what is quite frankly an amazing and cute dragon costume. Yeah, never trust a sign like that. So this game is a fixed camera angle mini collectathon. The vibe that this game gives off really reminded me of 40 Winks, if you ever played that game back in the day. The trail of treats leads us up to the back of a spooky house, which has a locked gate. So we continue down another path, which has three separate collections of groups of three rocks. At the end of the path, there is a sign that reads,
"Landscapers limit, ran out of budget after three rocks, beware, not all of them are real."
There seems to be three groups of three, so I think you know what that means. Each of these groups has one rock that is slightly longer than the rest, so I'm guessing it's left, right, and middle. Boom, what you got next, game? What the game has next is seemingly a word puzzle. So this note says that they somehow buried the bolt cutters instead of the person that owned them. So I was looking for a grave that had a name that sounded like bolt cutters, something like Colt Mutters or something like that, you know? But I think it's actually word association. So you have things like chefs and stuff like that buried in here. So of course, the bolt cutters belong to the bike thief. I don't know if there's a punishment for getting this wrong though. I also don't know how the fuck a gravedigger can bury an inanimate object instead of a dead human being, but there you go. Once the bolt cutters have been exhumed, this fucking Final Fantasy VII looking bad boy up here appears in the sky. Is he? Yeah, I think he's chasing us. He wasn't much of a threat, to be honest. So much so that I even, like, kind of backpedaled a bit to grab some more candy. Handy, really, because this demon head on the wall wants 25 of them to let me in. Fucking con artist. Once we're plonked inside, there's a stain on the floor below a yellow light, and a door with no doorknob. The next room has a door that requires a key, and a stain under a purple light. Interesting. The next room has a stain under a green light. And eventually we find a wine room full of coloured buttons, and a locked door that is surrounded by light bulbs. I think you know what we've got to do here. We push the yellow button, the green button, the purple button, and voila! Okay, this area is giving me very big medieval vibes, by the way, which is not a bad thing. Through the locked door, right. I know this game isn't that scary at all, but something about that bitch really put me on edge. In the next room, the bloody hoe from hell is chasing me around this tight room full of bookcases and weird camera angles. I do find the missing doorknob, but lose track of the woman. One swift retry later, we make it out of the maze with the doorknob. Upon sticking the doorknob in the door, we pass through and reach the end of the demo. Now, hear me out. I know the way this is edited and scripted might make this game look like it's not much and a bit of a game for babies. And it isn't a hard game by the looks of things, but what it is a fucking super charming, fun little game that seems to have a lot of love put into it and the theme that it's going for. It really taps into that feel of a PS1 game like Medieval and 40 Winks, full of little puzzles and cool characters and cool environments. I personally really enjoyed the demo and would actually love to play a full release. Excellent job. Next game. Okay, so The Drowning Machine is a game I don't really know how to review. Not that it's a bad game or anything even close to that, but it does deal with a very heavy subject matter, that being suicide. So the game was made by someone whose best friend, Charlie, took their own life. Not long before their passing, the two of them started development on this game. The creator decided to finish it as somewhat of a love letter to their departed friend, and to finish it as closely as they believed Charlie would have wanted the game to be. The game consists of you exploring very well-made and atmospheric environments that mirror real life, but real life if it was to be seen through a dreamlike state. As you are exploring each area, there is a poem that appears in text at the bottom of the screen, each poem being written by Charlie before their passing. As you progress, you receive messages on your phone that seem to reflect both other poems of Charlie's and the messages that the creator and other people who knew Charlie would have been sharing around the time it was discovered that they had committed suicide. The further you progress, the louder a sound of tight rope rocking back and forth can also be heard. It's very powerful stuff, and to be honest, it's too important to the creator or others that may have lost someone to something as horrible as suicide for me to write a dopey and jokey review around it. If you're someone who feels like suicide is their only option, remember that suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. No matter how hopeless it may seem, there is always tomorrow and always a chance for things to improve over time. If you ever have these feelings, always reach out and speak to someone, no matter who it may be, because you're never as alone as you think you are. So So, Tori 3D is a very cute and adorable platformer that controls buttery smooth and just has the most kawaii graphics I think I've ever seen. This isn't actually a horror game, but this is the Haunted PS1 exclusive demo, so they snuck in some creepy little elements for the demo disc, one of which being stars in the sky go evil and start chasing you. Now, while not technically a horror game, this is some seriously fun platforming, challenging you to collect all the stars on a level as you go. As you can see here, I got a little stuck with these jumps, so how's about we do a little death montage, eh? So as I said, this isn't a horror game, but I'm very glad for its inclusion, because they did add some horror moments and made an exclusive Haunted PS1 version of the demo. It's a great platformer and it really is a lot of fun, so I suggest you check it out if that is your kind of thing. Really good job. Next game. So this is Steel Ridge. Anyone who's ever played a very popular demo of one of Konami's biggest IPs might find this menu a little bit familiar. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. It's a PT clone. There is, of course, one big difference. This game is not from a first-person perspective, and is kind of like a PT version of Broken Sword in a way. So we grab our wallet, examine it to get our ID, then use that ID to pry open the door. Then, the old familiar loop begins. Now don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that this game isn't good. I know how much work and effort goes into making a game, and even if you're technically recreating PT in a different style of game, that will still take a lot of work. The thing is, I have to wonder, why PT? The game has been done to death in the indie horror scene, and if anyone sees it, they just kind of roll their eyes and go, oh, here we go again. Outside of some small technical errors, like the fact you can pick up items infinitely, the game does work really well though. There were some clunky moments where I was trying to figure out what to do, but the whole thing mainly revolves around this clock. You have to set it to different times to make different things happen in the corridor. First up is 8 o'clock. You have to adjust this radio, which took me about 5 minutes because the knob turns so strangely. I can't explain it, but it's just really weird. But once you do eventually find it, there's a radio presenter talking about a murder and giving us another time of 6 p.m. Now, for reasons that I don't actually remember, I changed the clock to 2 p.m. instead of 6, and then the door bangs as we walk past it. Upon inspection, we hear someone crying inside, and then just like in PT, as we walk away, the door opens a little bit. Upon returning to the door, the person inside actually gives you a little quest to find them some medicine. We already have one of the medicines that we found on the table, but the second one took me quite some time to figure out for some reason. You have to use these scissors that we found on another table on this bear, obviously, and then there are some more pills stashed inside it. We give the person these pills and they close the door on us and deliver us half a photo. I finally set the room to 6 p.m, which makes this little random fucker appear and mess with the coat on the rack. When we get there, we check it and it has a gun inside.
Listen to me, you son of a bitch. I made you. I fucking made you. And you dare threaten me over some bullshit you caused? If it weren't for me, you'd still be in that hellhole city you crawled out of, getting fucked by the grand jury. I'm sorry. We should discuss this like men. Sunderland Woods. Usual spot. Yeah, an hour.
Sunderland Woods, eh? Like the fucking protagonist in Silent Hill 2?
So yeah, a very weird phone call. Then this happens. And after we face fuck someone with a door, we're locked in the bathroom. So we do the classic horror movie thing of opening the shower curtain. Fucking red room? Really? Anyway, there's an axe stuck in the wall that we nab and smash the door down. Then we get the second half of the photo. And also some spookums. So we pop the picture back in the frame and that opens the Rolodex. The game says there's thousands of cards in here, and we need to select the date. I spent bloody ages looking for that fucking date. Turns out it's on the back of the photograph. After some nonsense story, the two locks and chains fall off the door. Get me out of here. So for a second I thought that maybe the game just looped here, but upon returning to the corridor, the monster is actually on the loose patrolling. You have to dip into the bathroom and then make a break for it when you can.
information, there's a little he would ask.
Now, if the game ended there, not too bad. But then there's this ending, which I'm going to fast forward for you, which literally made me say, what the fuck, out loud, after about 5 minutes of just random chatting, which is only about the halfway mark of this conversation. The amount of overly done exposition that just gets dumped on the player here at the end is so egregious. You spend about 2 minutes talking about fucking coffee. Oh yeah, then you know that guy we saw? He's here now.
Great!
I have no idea what was going on in this game. It's an odd combination of PT stories, puzzles, and settings, with some other random things thrown in there too. It was a fine game, it worked just fine. It's just, I don't really understand why you'd choose PT. It didn't really do much for me. But I can appreciate the effort that went into it, so good job. Next game. This game starts with a dog, so it's already a winner. Then it has this charming ass intro.
Hello. I'm Dr. F, Chief of Blue Knight Research. Welcome to the orientation film for the Blue Knight. As a member of the LRS, you will be expected to keep everything you see and hear confidential. The facility has been set up to conduct science experiments for the benefit of mankind. During your stay, you will be studying the native flora. We hope that your research is productive and helps us lead humanity into a new era of peace. The Age of Aquarius. You will enjoy all the comforts and amenities you expect from a state-of-the-art facility like the LRS. We even hope you can join us for Taco Tuesday at our own restaurant on the roof. Its quality is unheard of. Now, let me introduce you to the Global Unified Advanced Research Defense System, or GARD system. Our trusted guards are here to protect you from everything. We have set up the guards to make sure you enjoy your stay healthy. They will not attack humans. On behalf of the LRS and our science team, thank you, and good luck.
Now the game begins. We play as fucking Magnum PI, and I absolutely love that we do. And the game largely revolves around stealth and exploring. You have to avoid the guards, and if they see you, they will one-shot you with a fucking electric fist up the ass. As you continue, if you explore correctly, you find energy upgrades that increase your energy bar in the corner, which covers things like sprinting and even special powers. Speaking of which... yeah, this game is amazing. Eventually we get to a terminal that opens up a warehouse. We sneak in, and the game teaches us that we can fist motherfuckers too. And this is where I thought the demo would end, honestly. However, we find another map that shows there's a warehouse with six exits, which is where the serious exploration begins. Look at the fucking size of one of these directions. So as you can imagine, there's going to be a lot cut out of this video, because we explore, find more energy upgrades, and get fisted a fair few times. Eventually, I have enough energy to pull off the ultimate move. You activate your guard camouflage, walk up to them, and give them a fucking fist in. It's basically an auto win, but I don't mind so much because there's a lot of sneaking around in this game. And once you knock someone out, you can't sprint or use any other powers for 5 seconds. So it's pretty fair, kind of like a risk and reward situation. One thing I'm really pleased with is I found this secret room by punching through a wall. I don't know what it all means, but it's a cool touch either way. We eventually stumble across another power, the ability to dash. I was going to do some more exploring, but I thought I'd found a secret and I dashed across this gap and the demo ended. I was actually really disappointed because I didn't even look at the other two sides of the warehouse, and this demo still took me an hour to complete. This game is fucking amazing. If you enjoy stealth games, it's really, really good. You have to juggle the risk and reward situations, and I think it's got a hell of a lot of potential, and I would fully pay to play the full version of this game. There's a lot of care and attention that went into it, and the developers seriously seem to know what they're doing, so excellent work. Next game!
Distant bird calls welcome the night. NH, no matter how far you walk, you never feel like you're there. Standing up from the chair, the unnamed tosses a book to the ground. The itch intensifies. They forget. They need to scratch what is in their chest. Shoes get pulled over their heels. A jacket wrapped around their shape. The door is opened. They emerge. Now, they are almost in your hands. Almost.
So, An Outcry is a game using the RPG Maker engine. I love RPG Maker games, and this one is really well put together. So we play as someone called The Unnamed, who leaves their apartment for a cigarette because they get the itch, which I believe is a literal itch because of the addiction of smoking, which, as an ex-smoker, I can confirm is really well explained and used in the game. Also, judging by the way other arsehole residents in the apartment talk to you, purposely calling you boy or saying you're a boy but lady, the itch might also refer to the feeling of someone who requires a sex change, the sort of itch of being in a body that doesn't quite feel right to them. It also seems like they get dead named here as well, further reinforcing that idea. The story revolves around this character and their mission to get some cigarettes after locking themselves out of their apartment, interacting with other residents, one of them being a lovely friend who has always got your back and accepts you for who you are. Eventually, we do get some cigarettes and head outside. While we're out there having a smoke, we hear some sort of outcry. We get the choice to ignore or follow the outcry, which I chose to follow. Then, bizarrely, a bird speaks to us and seems to threaten us before fucking off. This seems to break our character's sanity a little bit, setting off their anxiety as a flock of birds make their way towards them in a corridor. Up until our trusty best friend lets us into their apartment. Our friend calls us a locksmith, and we discuss the outcry, a sound which sounded like boots marching, and sirens wailing, and screams within screams, whispers walking around, going door to door. It seems we both heard it, whatever it was. We eventually make our way back to our apartment, and the door is ajar. Believing this was possibly the locksmith, we head inside and go to get some sleep. Now, I clearly cut out about 90% of this demo because it is all talking, reading, walking around, interacting with the world around you. The world and the characters are incredibly fleshed out and well written, and it makes for an amazing experience if you're one who can get into the whole RPG Maker styled games. This one is seriously worth checking out if that is your thing. Really well made. Great job. Next game. Thieb Adventures is yet another adorable platformer where you play as this big nose thing. They also have the amazing ability to swing through the skies like Spider-Man. And honestly, this little web-slinging ability controls so well, I almost feel like it gives Marvel a run for its money. The Monkey King shouts at me to give him some bananas, so let's go for a wander.
What the fuck is this? Oh. Okay, I've got 9,999 bananas now.
Well, that is one way to get into a castle, I guess. This little geezer over here was sleeping with his eyes open and is supposed to stop us going any further into the castle, but really doesn't care enough to do that. So we'll attach some of our sticky nose liquid to this switch and crack on then, shall we? I don't think we'll require these platforms. The game continues on with some rather fun little physics puzzles, but I'll tell you one thing, I died a lot in this game. I found this ominous little room, and try as I might, I never did find a red key. Sad face. So I already grabbed the blue key in another area that was super easy, but the green key gets us this nice little ride on this orbocopter. We fly back down and head to the key door to continue on. We eventually find the throne room of the recently deceased Monkey King.
Yeah.
It goes without saying that this game was fucking amazing. It really was such a good time. It has a fantastic sense of humor and some oddly dark moments. I highly recommend this little number, and it is one that I'll personally be keeping an eye out for. I would really happily pay for a full release of this game, so fingers crossed we get one. Amazing work. Final game. Loveland, or Loveland, I don't know which one it is a demo I've actually played on this channel before. There isn't much new on display here, but a few new rooms and some new set dressings. You are a detective investigating some missing persons in a place called Loveland. As you make your way around the tiny trailer park, you are constantly stalked by people you never see, but can only hear in the distance or just behind you. There is some really weird shit going on with frogs. The people here are basically making frog shine out of them, and when they drink it, they seem to be put under some sort of cult-like state of psychosis. This is one of the new rooms. They have one of the poor suckers strapped to a chair, watching some kind of weird ass TV hypno torture and forcing him to drink moonshine. Something that's pretty cool is you can find a Blockbuster VHS on one of these shelves, and it's the haunted PS1 tape. I remember this room from the original. I don't know what these things are, but there's some kind of spiders, so I hate them being all around me on the loose like this. Oh, and there's also a man cocooned alive, which is possibly my new worst nightmare. Another room that I don't seem to remember from the original demo is this hatching day room. It has some uncomfortable connotations and causes quite a ruckus. We've been collecting 3 medallion pieces that we can put into this gate to continue up the hill, which is where the demo ends. I'm really curious to see where this game goes. I really like its setting, and I love the vibe that it's got going. There's lots of potential, and it's really quite spooky at times. Let me get my hands on a full release, you bastards. Anyway, so that's all the games, but we have one more thing to go. So with all the games done, we can now explore the museum a little bit more. Downstairs is a little PC in the bar room, which is locked with a password. The password is found in the bathroom, split into two parts. Once you pop that in, you go through some emails on this PC and you download lots of pictures. They're all pretty unsettling and kind of like dark web discoveries. Then you find a video. And honestly, I'm just going to show you this because it is by far the most unsettling part of this entire experience. Whoever made this, fucking well done. And there we go, everyone. Haunted PS1 Demo Disc 2021. I'm really sorry this took me so long to get it out. My last video was Resident Evil Village, and it's crazy, but that video came out like 25 days ago at the time of recording, and that is a bloody big gap. I really didn't think that this video would take me that long. Stupid, really, since it has 25 fucking games on it. So of course it did. But it's here. The next video is already in production, so that will take me nowhere near the same amount of time. I will try not to ever let more than 2 weeks pass between videos, but sometimes sometimes life gets in the way and time just flies when you're not looking. So I'm really sorry about that. We've got a few new people subscribing too, which is always nice to see. Thanks to all the new subscribers, and also thanks to anyone who has been subscribed for however long you have, and you've stuck around for however long you have. I really appreciate it. If you made it this far and you're hearing this, type hashtag Scully in the comment down below so I know who the real MVPs are. Zooming across the bottom of the screen now are the members of my Patreon. They're absolute legends, and for their coolness and their generosity, they got this huge video earlier than YouTube, and there's a link in the description if you'd be interested in joining that yourself. But yeah, I'm super sorry about the huge gap. Thank you so much for your patience, and thank you so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye for now.